some exercises for you people to do. Has anyone tried these exercises? So let me ask the first one. Has anyone tried using the conservation of stress? Conservation of the stress tensor, using the fact that we have del z bar t z z bar del w bar t plus u w bar is equal to del z del w of t z. Wrong. Del z z bar del w bar of t z z. Has anyone tried to use this relationship to pull out G alpha alpha equal to
0 is
equal to minus C. Has anyone done this and got the constant? Did you get the right answer?
Was there a minus?
Anyone else? Okay, I won't ask you to repeat.
Minus.
But okay, let's check even if there is a minus sign. I think there is. We'll go through it in a moment. But okay, I won't ask you to come to the board. That'll just take too much time. Okay. So Jyoti was right. Jyoti and Mahesh right. What about the second exercise, which is computing the matrix of?
That comes out to be something like C by 2 0 0 0.
Zero, zero, zero.
If you consider it on the vacuum.
On the vacuum state.
Yeah, otherwise it's
some
complicated H and H square.
Exactly. So already that is sufficient to tell you.
Because there will be a vacuum always, and this has to be greater than 0, therefore C has to be.
Very good. So, Jyoti Boy gave the answer. when I did the calculation for the most general thing, by the way, I got the following. The most general matrix I got the following. I got 4H plus C by 2. 4H into H plus 2H plus 1. As the matrix of Hamming products. Okay? As Jyoti Mai says, all you needed to know to get the result that C must be greater than 0 for unitarity, all you need to do is apply this to the special case of the identity operator of the vacuum, in which case the positivity of C is simply the positivity of this matrix. Okay? But this general result for a general operator will also be useful later on, okay, in determining, negative norm states. It's a sort of interesting exercise to compute the determinant of this matrix. Okay, I'll leave that as an exercise for you to do. I'll just give you the answer. The answer turns out to be, suppose you compute the determinants. This was 6H, this was 6H. And this was 4H. Okay, if you compute the determinant of this matrix, you get the following answer. You get z' is equal to H minus H1, H minus H1 into H minus H2 into H minus H3, where H1 is equal to 0. H2 is equal to H2 and H3 are equal to 16 into 5 minus C plus minus plus 1 by 16 into square root of 1 minus C into 25 minus C. Okay, it's just solving for some quadratic equation. It becomes a quadratic equation because you get a factor of H immediately outside, so then it's quadratic. So you can factorize this expression for the determinant. The important point is that you see that certain values of, you see for instance, that the determinant is not always positive. Okay, you've got these two different values. Okay, and if you're in between these, if H is in between H2 and H3, H is greater than 0, let's say, But in between H2 and H3, okay, then the dominant would go negative. Right? Because it's a product of three factors, two of which are positive and one which is negative. If the determinant's negative, it's impossible for for all eigenvalues of the matrix to be positive. Okay? So this already gives you some restriction based on unitarity on the operator content of a theory, okay, with central charge C. Okay? You see, we're getting restrictions saying that the H of the theory cannot lie in a certain range depending on what C is.
But this constraint is there only if the square root is...
This constraint is there only if the square root is not an imaginary number. Exactly. So it's so that also tells you that... So, for instance... now have I got this... Yeah. So, if C is less than 1, or if C is greater than... if C is less than 1, then that condition that Loganaga pointed out is met. Okay, this is some positive real number. So when C is less than 1, you find that for models to which C is less than 1, you find this constraint. Okay, given a value of C, already the simple calculations told us that you can't, that not all values of scaling dimensions of primary operators are allowed. Okay? There's some restriction. Now, this is the restriction that we got from level 2. You could try to do the same calculation in level 3. And so, and try to satisfy all constraints that come from unitarity. Okay? And if you go ahead and do that, you find, though I don't think in this class we'll actually go through this calculation, but if you go ahead and do that, it turns out that you find that when C is less than 1, unitarity severely constrains the possibilities. It turns out that you can have unitary theories if and only if C takes one of a set of discrete values, an infinite set of discrete values. And then given that particular value of C, the possible allowed values of H in that theory are some finite number of values. Okay? So there's a set of two integers in terms of which all values of C that are less than 1 that are consistent with unitarity are parametrized. And given that those particular set of integers, the range of possible H's with some other parameter which runs over a finite set of values is also specified. So just unitarity in a conformal field theory with central charge less than 1 tells you a great deal about the structure of the theory. It tells you that the central charge can't be anything, it has to be one of the discrete set of values. It tells you once you know the central charge, the operator scaling dimensions can't be anything, they have to take one of a finite number of values. Okay? So, unitarity gives you important constraints on the physics of conformality in theory with C less than 1. For every value of central charge allowed by this unitarity analysis, there exists at least one conformal field theory. These have been constructed by direct construction. Okay, with that value of the central charge and with some of these operators. These theories are called the minimal models. And it turns out that these values of not every operator is allowed in these things. Only operators with very distinguished scaling dimensions. Now, the reason we can't have every scaling dimension in the game is that if you move the scaling dimension a little bit, the normal sum state will go negative. If that's going to happen, it must have been that the norms of some state were zero at the distinguished values of H. That is indeed the case. So these minimal models are models in which you have the representation theory has some null states. Because of which, for the reasons we talked about in the last class, you can write down differential equations that
health constrained behavioral correlation functions, and essentially solve for these brackets. Okay? So, although this is not, none of what I said is going to be terribly important for the direct line of attack of our class, okay? It's an interesting point that minimal model, that conformal field theories with C less than 1 are completely classified and essentially all solved. You know, if any conformal field theory in two dimensions with central charge is the one, you've got a complete classification of it and you more or less complete solution. And this illustrates the power of these techniques. What other dimension, you know, you can't generally solve for a quantum field theory. In these cases, you can. By solve, I mean, find the full operator spectrum, find all correlation functions. Okay, so this was a comment I wanted to make about this norm calculation. Okay, if you want to read a little more about this kind of stuff, these lecture notes by Ginsberg called Applied Conformal Field Theory. Are a good source of it. I think the Lesouche lecture notes from 1988. Huh? They're a good source to start, and they'll give you references. Okay, so that's all I want to say about this first thing. Now let's quickly go through the second calculation.
What is that zero up there? Which one is Z?
The spinless plane.
Okay. And
in
H2,
okay. There's a question for why, you know, there's a way to understand that there had to be an H in this formula. Can anyone tell me why there has to be an H in this formula? What is zero?
It's
I'm not taking that. Okay, so it's from calculation, but is there a more structured way of understanding this? Is it simple way to understand this fact is that at level 1, we did the calculation of norms of states. And we found that the norm was equal to H. Okay, now, suppose we have a state with zero norm at level 1. That implies the existence of a state with zero norm at level 2. Because you take that level 1 state and act on it with some basic operator. Okay? And you do the norm calculation for that other state, that would relate the norm of this new state to the norm of the level 1 state with 0. Okay, so you get some number times 0, and therefore 0. Okay? So, this is a general fact that any state that is a descendant of a state with 0 norm will also have 0. Okay? So, since at H equals 0, there was a level 1 state with 0 norm at level 1, there must be at least one state with 0 norm at level 3. At level 2, the descendants of that zero norm state. Okay? This will be a general fact about this determinant, by the way, has a name. Determinant of all inner products of states at level n has a name. It's called the Karch determinant. And Karch has given an explicit formula for this determinant at every
KAC.
Has given an explicit formula for this determinant at every level, which is what is used to give the analysis of allowed values of central charge and allowed values of scaling dimensions of operators that I mentioned. Okay, so this was a bit of a diversion, but about something quite interesting about conformality theorem. It will not form the heart of what we talk about when we study string theory. Okay, good. So now let's get back to the second. So let's do the second exercise. So the second exercise was this thing. Let's see. So we have this nice equation which tells us that del z of tzz bar times del w of tww bar is equal to del z bar del w bar of tzz tww. Okay, now, so suppose I call suppose I define TZZ bar, TW W bar, and define that as F. Then I compute it to del Z, del W of F. F is a function of Z W. Then I compute it to del Z, del W of F is equal to del Z bar, del W bar of C by 2 of Z minus W. Right? Now, let me rewrite this quantity in terms of one Z and one W derivative of something. Okay? So I can rewrite that as del W del Z bar del W bar of 1 over Z minus W the whole thing squared, except that I need an additional factor of 2 times 3 and a minus sign. Because one of, when I differentiate, I get 2 minus signs, but the third one, because one of these is just like W of the other one, just like Z. Okay? So the final answer is equal to minus C by 12. Is this clear? Okay? Now I integrate both sides. Don't worry too much about what I get as constants of integration. So F, this tells me that F is minus C by 12 times del Z bar del W bar of 1 over Z minus W, the whole thing squared. Okay? Now, let me write 1 over Z minus W, the whole thing squared, as equal to del W del Z of log of Z minus W into Z bar minus W. Z bar minus W bar is going off to the right. I put it there to get a real expression. Because it differentiates to 0. But I put it there so I get a nice real expression. Okay, now let's check the minus signs. If minus signs work out okay, because we would have got one minus sign from differentiating 1 by x, and one minus sign from one of the derivatives, which is the W. So finally, we consider that f is equal to minus c by 12, del z bar, del w bar, of log of R squared, where R is mod, the mod Z squared. Is this clear? So, what have we concluded? We've concluded that TZZ bar, TWW bar, is equal to minus C by 12, del Z bar, del W bar of log of R. Now, it was convenient to do the calculation in this complex notation, but it's convenient to interpret the answer in covariant notation. Okay, so if these things are each proportional to T alpha contracted, whatever proportionality constant is needed to convert these to those things, same as proportionality constant needed to convert this to del squared. Right? So I can rewrite this as T alpha alpha of Z times T beta beta of W is equal to minus C by 12 del squared in the variable Z, del squared in the variable W of log of Z, mod Z minus W squared. Is this clear? Okay. Now, what can we say about del squared of the log of R squared? Okay. What can we say about del squared of log of R squared? Now, in two dimensions, I will declare the del square of log of r is equal to 2 pi times the del of r. How do I know this? Well, I know this using Stokes' theorem. You see, because del of log of r is equal to r hat divided by r. Therefore, integral del log r over a circle is equal to 2 pi. Okay? But that must be the same as the volume integral of del square log r over the plane. Okay? Which tells me that del square log r must be 2 pi times the del. Okay? Yeah, of course, it's easy to check that del square log r is 0 everywhere, except perhaps at r equals 0. But there's a singularity there, you see, from this application of the Stokes theorem. Okay? So, this formula can be written as T set Z over T alpha alpha of Z, T beta beta of W is equal to minus C by 6 del squared minus C by 6 del squared of the delta function. That's the question. I made 12 6 because this was r squared, and this relation has been log r relation factor. You might argue with minus signs from the fact that some of the derivatives are z derivatives and some of them are w derivatives, but we always have two derivatives, it's even number of derivatives, so there's no issues with minus signs. Okay, so we've concluded that this equation is true. Okay, now what does that tell us? What does that tell us about the trace of the stress tensor on an arbitrary curve, on an arbitrary map? Okay, well, what do we get? You see, you remember, as I reminded you last time, the change in T alpha alpha was equal to minus 1 by 4 pi times integral of 2 omega, let's say, x. And T alpha alpha x d beta beta y, let's call this of x, of y, d2y. But this was the change in the value of t alpha alpha x under eta goes to e to the power 2 omega. Okay? And this is it's followed from the definition of our stress tensor, and you know what the change in the metric was under this small change, this small conformal transformation. Fine. So now let's use our formula for the two-point function of the stress tensor. Okay. So we get del squared of a delta function, integrate by parts, have the del squared act on the other side. On the omegas, so we finally get the change of t alpha alpha x is equal to the change of t alpha alpha of x is equal to is equal to, so the 2 pi's cancel, this is so we get c by 6 times del squared of omega. Get confused with whether there's a minus c. Yeah.
there should be a minor complexity. Let me check it out. I may request you to wait till next class for me to care whether that's a minus sign or not. I'll give you the final answer going into which is I think I missed a minus sign somewhere. Okay, sorry. But now what? You see, but we have that we had some general considerations. We had some general considerations that the alpha was equal to some number A times alpha. Now, we know how the alpha-alpha changes under a change in a conformal attribution. So all we have to do is to see how the right-hand side changes under a change in the conformal transformation. Okay? And it's easy to check that this thing changes by A times del square of 2. Okay, this is a standard formula that you pull out of Biren and Dimas. So you work it. Okay, so comparing these two, we see that A has to be equal to C by 12. Unfortunately, it should be like minus C by 12. So I've missed a minus sign somewhere. Hey, let's not try to track down the minus sign here. Just waste time. I'll get it for the next class. It's not worth the time. I'm sure we can do it at 10 minutes. Okay. So I'll track down the minus sign carefully next time. Sorry for that. But up to the minus sign, we've got this answer. Okay. Now, so we've concluded, although we concluded the minus sign wrong, that T alpha is equal to minus C by 12. Okay. This is a completely universal result. It's universal in the sense that the only thing about the conformal field theory that it depends on is the central charge. By the way, all we used here is the left-moving central charge. We used the quantity that appears in the operator product expansion of T with T, left-moving side. But we could have done the same calculation with the right-moving central. And we would have got the same answer, of course. So, if the left-moving central charge of our theory was not equal to the right-moving central charge of our theory, then something is wrong. Right? Because we do a calculation, and we get one answer from the left-moving central charge. Do another calculation, we get another answer from the right-moving central charge. So, this conclusion is correct. Actually, you see, the thing that we've used importantly all over the place, assumed importantly, is we maintain diffeomorphism invariants. So, what we see is that there's nothing wrong with the conformal field theory just in flat space with left-moving and right-moving central charges different. However, if you want the theory to be diffeomorphically invariant, that is, you want to be able to define it in a diffeomorphically invariant way on an arbitrary manifold, the only way that can be done is that the left-moving and right-moving central charges are equal. Okay? Theories with different left-moving and right-moving central charges have what is called a diffeomorphism, or sometimes a gravitational anomaly. Okay? And that anomaly is simply the statement that it's not consistently possible to lift, if something breaks down if you try to lift the theory to an arbitrary, arbitrary space that's not arbitrary space. Okay? I want to point out one consequence of this fact. A consequence of the fact that the trace to stress tensor is determined just by the central charge. That's curvature. Okay. This statement is more powerful than you might first think. It's more powerful than you might first think for the following reason.
suppose you had suppose you were interested in conformality theories with the metric G alpha beta is equal to eta alpha beta times eta pi. Okay? Now, under a small change in phi, you can compute how the partition function of this theory changes. Because under a small change in phi, the change in the partition function is going to be proportional to the trace of the stress tensor in that theory times the change in phi with some proportionality factor that we have to carefully keep track of, as always, minus 4 pi and so on in these C's. This is clear, that's why the definition of the stress tensor. But we already know what the trace is in terms of as a function of phi. So, we get an equation of the form with some constants that you have to keep track of. Delta z is proportional to integral delta phi times minus c by times, okay, I'm not even trying to keep track of constants, delta r, where r itself can easily be written down in terms of phi. So, you've got a functional differential equation, okay, which is actually possible quite easily. It's possible to quite easily sum up this. Okay? I want you to do this in an exercise. Exercise show that z is equal to, you know, some number which you determine times pi del squared. So z is equal to e to the power some number that you will determine times pi del squared pi. Solves the function differential equation that you get from probabilities.
Times the z delta phi.
Times delta phi equals 0, which you could treat as 1. Yeah, times, exactly. Okay, so this relationship here has allowed us to determine the partition function of the conformal field theory for any metric of the form that is conformally related to flat space. That is related by wire leading to flat space. Okay, but now suppose we consider an arbitrary metric. By a few orders of invariance, up to possible discrete global problems, we've already used the statement that we can always use a few orders of invariance to put the metric into such a form. So if we maintain diffeomorphism invariance, as we've always been doing, then this information is enough to determine the partition function for the theory in an arbitrary manner. You see, not just a manifold that is conformally related to flat space, because every manifold is related by a conformal plus a diffeomorphism transformation to flat space, up to some global. Therefore, all we have to do is to search for a covariant expression that reduces to this expression for metrics of that form. And you're done. So this is part one. Part two of the exercise is to show that that the covariant expression is z is equal to e to the power of other number times r 1 by l squared. And then there's the right square root of g. The basic point is that r is dead squared phi. Once you take it above, right? That is essentially r is dead squared phi, so that dead squared phi, 1 by dead squared phi is this. You know, with some numerical constants. So, this number, of course, is determined by the central charge. With central charge, but either they're moving on the right move with central charge. All of these manipulations only make sense in the theory in which both are equal. Okay? And you see what we've concluded? We see that we've concluded is that we have incredible power in these two dimensions of the form of these theories. If you know the central charge of the theory, and you know the partition function of the theory in flat space, You know the partition function of the theory of any arbitrary manifold. Okay? It's the difference between these two partition functions is just a fact that it depends only on the central charge. Hey, isn't this quite incredible? I mean, it's just such a simple manipulation gives you such powerful results. Okay? So this is part of the answer to the question, why is the central charge important? Okay. Now, there's one other calculation that I wanted to outline for you. That says the same thing but in different words, and in words that you may find physically more appealing. Okay. I want to reiterate the statement that the trace of t is minus c by 12 times r, but from another point of view. It's the same point of view, right? But slightly different point of view. Okay. And this point of view is the following. Under a conformal transformation, we know how the stress tensor transforms. As we have seen, the transformation for analytic epsilons is given by delta t is equal to the pole in epsilon of z times t z. The residue of the pole inverse. Okay? And if epsilon is analytic, we've seen that there are three terms in the residue of the pole. There's epsilon prime of z, there's epsilon prime of z times del t, there's plus 2 epsilon, epsilon of z times del t plus 2 epsilon prime of z times t, and then there's plus maybe I should just do this, sorry. Okay, so let's look at the so we have epsilon of z times 1 c by 2 z minus w to the 4 plus 2t of z minus w squared plus del t of w. Okay, we want the residue of the pole here. So we get del t of w plus the term that comes from the first term of the Taylor series expansion here. So that's plus 2t of w, okay, times epsilon prime of 0 and w. Let's say w 0. That's okay. And then plus we get the term that has 3 powers of z minus w. Yeah. So we get epsilon triple prime at w by 6. So that's c by 12. C by 12 times times nothing, times identity.
Yeah, the first one we have an epsilon.
And this one has an. Okay. Now these two terms, we understand what they mean. They're simply the transformations of t under the coordinate change that was part of the conformal transformation. Okay? This is just the tensorial behavior of the stress tensor. However, a conformal transformation is not just a coordinate change. It's a coordinates change plus a wildly scaling. This is a wildly scaling by what? See, if we make the transformation z is equal to z prime plus epsilon of z, then the new vector e to the power to first order epsilon prime of z prime plus epsilon z bar times dz prime dz bar prime. So the coordinate change changes the metric like this. In order to get a conformal transformation, that is, to get the metric back to flat space in the new coordinates, we have to perform a wire transformation with minus of this factor. Okay? So conformal transformation is the sum of coordinate change plus wire transformation. The wire transformation needed in this case is that with e to the power minus epsilon prime of z plus epsilon bar prime of z bar. Okay? So this third term here must represent the change in the stress tensor under the wire transformation. Okay? So, now let us try to rewrite what that change in the stress tensor under the wire transformation is in terms of the wire factor in a more invariant way. Okay? So the wire factor was W. So this twice the wire factor was equal to epsilon prime so this change which is triple derivative of this thing here tells us that change in Tzz under wire transformation you can write this as minus C by 12 times del Z cube. Let's call it del Z squared of del Z of epsilon, which is the same thing as del Z squared of 2 omega. Because this part is anti-analytic, and so skilled by the solution to this. Okay, so although we know how the stress tensor transforms under only very specific kinds of wire transformations, it's easy to guess a general formula, which would be valid for any wire transformation, that reduces the stress. Okay, that's the formula. Because if this was the right arm formula, then you plug in this thing for the special case of W equals this, you get the right answer. Yeah, and then it has to be something, you know, that depends only locally on the y factor and so on. So though I'm not trying to do it carefully, you probably argue that this is enough information to uniquely fix this. Okay, that's great, but now we use. We use diffeomorphism invariants so that the equation that Tzz del Z bar is equal to del Z of Tzz bar with the minus sign. With the minus sign and so let's put a del z bar here. So I put a del z bar here. So that tells me what the change in del z del this thing is. I cancel one del z by integration. So the final conclusion is that that delta of Tzz bar is equal to again I have a minus sign. Anyway, I'll clear up both minus signs. Let's C by 12 times it must have been wrong in this, you know, whether we want to minus this or plus this. So let's have it. Okay. So this is del z bar of del z bar of 2W. Okay, but then once again raising indices, this is T alpha alpha is equal to C by 12 times del squared of 2W. But this is how the curvature density changes. Okay, so that tells you that T alpha alpha, if T alpha alpha is form A R, A is C by 12. Again, I see to match up the minus sign. I wonder if I've got
I'll clear out these minus signs. There's some minus sign problem I have in my head, which I'll clear out for next class. I'm working consistently and getting positive. I must be doing something consistently wrong. So, okay? So once again, we get the conclusion that A is equal to C by 12. Okay? The nice thing about this derivation, is that it makes itself really clear what this anomalous term, in the stress tensor transformation is. It's not a mystery, it's simply the transformation of T under a wire transformation. Okay? And is linked to the fact that the trace of stress tensors. Okay, good. The last thing I want to say about this reasoning about this stuff is something I should have started with but didn't because I think we were at the end of the class and forgot. Was this equation. You see, we keep saying that T alpha alpha is equal to A times R, and then we try to determine the value of A. But how do we know that this is the right form for T alpha? You know, why couldn't it be something else? So, can anyone help me with the argument? Can anyone come up with a general argument that says that? Then, so the first thing we know is that T alpha alpha is equal to 0 in fact. Then next, what else? Could T alpha alpha depend on the state of the theory? Well, actually we've been doing it for expectation value, but this is a stronger statement. It's actually a statement, an operator statement. T alpha alpha is this. The answer is no. Because, you see, this, the theory is T alpha alpha classically is 0. So quantum mechanically, the way you get some non-zero value for T alpha alpha is from regulating the theory. Some measure effect, which comes from short distance singularities. That is always insensitive, in any quantum theory, it's insensitive to the state of the theory. There's something that happens at very short distances. Okay? It's determined just by effectively the vacuum charge. So every finite energy state is like a vacuum at extremely short distance. Okay? So it's some effect that comes from some careful regulation, happens at very short distances, cannot depend on the state of the theory. Okay, so what we have in our hands, it could depend on some parameter of the theory, and it could depend on the metric. Now, we're in the conformity theory. So there are no, if it depends on the parameters of the theory, it does depend on some parameter, it depends on the center of the theory. But if it depends on some parameter of the theory, that parameter, whatever it is, cannot have any dimensions. Because the theory is conformed. Okay, so we have to make up our dimensions from derivatives of the metric. Now, what did we get? This thing here is dimension 2. So we want some scalar on the right hand side that has dimension 2. What could it be? It's the metric. No, it's the curvature scalar. Basically, there's no other candidate. You might say, well, suppose it didn't have dimension 2, okay, you're telling me that everything here has come from short distance effects. Okay? So, suppose what we got was not something with dimension 2, but dimension, let's say, 4, and it's made up by some power of that short distance regulator. Okay, that's possible, and indeed if you do a calculation in which you've regulated them, that would be true. You get some contribution to the trace of the stress tensor, let's say r to the 4. But that is not mass dimension 4, so it comes with an explicit distance cutoff square. Then when you take the continuum, nothing matters. Okay? So basically, you might ask, what about something to dimension 1 or 0? Well, there is no covariant scalar with dimension 1 or 0 that doesn't, there's just no covariant scalar with dimension 1 or 0. Okay? So there's basically not too many options here. Actually, the last argument was not quite needed, but anyway, it's true.
satisfies. So the only thing this could win as an operator statement is A times curve, which is K. And now we've got lots of fancy ways to determine ways of the minus signs that I give you.
Okay, but we can have in theory, even then you can have some fluids which together form the give this direction.
Well, you would have to do it in a way that was zero in flat space. Okay? So you see, the curvature scalar already is the lowest dimension scalar. Okay? That has dimension 2. If you add additional things, you only get higher dimensions. You could try to do something with fields that without the scale, curvature scale, but then you get a non-zero answer in that space. Okay? So basically, there are no other, there are essentially no other options.
Okay, what I was getting at was, is there any argument why this should be more like independent of even the theory? I can understand that it should be independent of the state.
Right.
But why is this true for, you know, all theories in Africa? I mean, with what you see being over derivative.
You see, once we've argued that it's of this form, then we have a derivation that this parameter is C. Okay, so there's not much more to say about that. The important question is, why is it of this form? And then we just see what else will it be. Now, you might ask, you see, there's probably something better to say about that. See, this in the end is an anomaly. Okay, I have the feeling that this is not the best answer to your question. But I don't want to risk saying something inaccurate here, so let me stop. There's something more to say. Well, okay, let's discuss this afterwards. Okay, look. Other questions, comments? Okay. Great. Now there's one last thing that I wanted to talk about. That was general to conformal field theories in general, before going on to study the specific conformal field theory of the free scalar field. And this last thing is this Kani formula that many of you have heard of, and that's very, very simple, but also very interesting. Okay, so suppose we consider a conformal field theory. Suppose we consider a conformal field theory on a torus. The partition function of conformal field theory on a torus whose space dimension is length 2 pi. And whose time direction is named beta. We're doing this partition function in Euclidean space. So though I call one of the directions space and the other one time, these two things are completely infinite. Okay? But supposedly now I focus on conformal field theories with no fermions in them, so we don't have to worry about boundary conditions. There's an extension of what you say to fermions, but we won't get to that. Let's be simple. Okay. Now, suppose, the first thing I want to remind you of is that this partition function has a simple interpretation in Hilbert space dimension. This is simply equal to the trace of e to the power minus beta h. Trace of e to the power minus beta h of the theory, where h is the Hamiltonian of the theory, h is the Hamiltonian of the theory. Given this
given this interpretation, okay, one can easily compute what this partition function is in the limit of very large beta. Why is that? See, because in the limit of very large beta, this partition function is dominated by the lowest energy statements here. But we've already seen that in any unitary conformity theory, the lowest energy state is the state due to the vacuum. And it has energy zero in the plane, but that translated to L0 and L0 bar both equal to minus C by 24. And therefore, energy, which is L0 plus L0 bar, equals minus C by 12 on the cylinder. Right. We saw that, you see, the vacuum is scaling dimension zero. But there was a shift between energies on the cylinder and scaling dimension zero on the plane. The shift was by a factor of minus C by 24 for L0. Similarly, there's a shift of minus C bar by 24 for L not bar.
C bar is the
right moving center direction. Yeah. Let's assume that C is equal to C bar. This is one of these diffeomorphisms in many things. Okay? So you get a total shift of minus C by 12. Minus C by 12 in L not plus L not bar. Okay? So the lowest energy state of the theory is vacuum, it's unique, and its energy is minus C by 12. Okay? So, when beta is large, we have this partition function again, and this approximation means we're dropping terms that are exponentially suppressed in e to the power minus beta, but this coefficient is accurate. It's one that is this, because this is a unique constant. The degeneracy is one. Okay, good. So far, so good. All that we've said is that at very low temperatures, the partition function is dominated by the vacuum. Who didn't know that? However, now let's look at this. Now let's take this partition function. View it slightly differently. You see, let me just take this torus and flip it around in my mind. Okay, so it becomes a torus. One of whose sides is beta here. And the sign here is 2 pi. See, I'm doing a partial pendulum torus, which I call the x side and which I call the y side. It's totally up to me. So this is also the answer to that thing. Now I do the next crucial step. Okay. I realize that by a scale transformation, I can shift this to a torus which then is 4 pi squared divided by beta and 2 pi. Merely by performing a wire rescaling, which is everywhere uniform. Because I'm performing a uniform wire rescaling, the partition function of my theory does not change. We just derive that. All changes appear with derivatives of that. Del squares of the wire factor when you perform a wire transformation. Okay? So this partition function of this theory, it's the same as partition of function in this theory, and therefore is the same as part. So we have that z of 4 pi squared, 4, and this is 2 pi squared, 2 pi squared by beta, is equal to e to the power c beta by 12, when beta is very large. But all these manipulations are exact. But we only know the answer to this when this side is the is true when beta is large.
So okay, but this statement is difficult. You already said that there's a low temperature, high temperature.
Exactly. Yes. You see, that is Right. It's just a property of the path table. That's right. Okay. So So look back on point first. We already made a statement: z of beta is equal to z of 2 pi squared by beta. This is an exact statement. That's true. Okay. But we only know the left hand side when beta is pretty large. Okay. Fine. So now let's rewrite this in terms of the argument of this one. So let's define beta prime equals 2 pi the whole thing squared divided by beta. Okay, so we define beta prime, which is 2 pi the whole thing squared divided by beta. And then substitute this in to this expression. So what do we get? We get z of beta prime is equal to e to the power c by 12 beta prime, and then divided by beta prime, we've got a 2 pi squared up as we need of by divide. Beta prime divided by 2 pi squared is 1. And this now holds at no beta. Okay. So the log of the partition function. The log of the partition function is equal to c pi squared by 3 beta prime. Or you interpret beta prime as an inverse temperature, is equal to c pi squared by 3 into the temperature. Okay? So the free energy of the theory, which is minus t times log of the beta function, is c pi squared by 3 t squared minus. Okay? Once you know the free energy of your theory, you can compute both the entropy density, okay, and the energy density. Okay? I'll leave this as an exercise for you, but I want you to show that up to some numbers, in this form, this formula tells you that you've got c times some number times the entropy density of your theory scales like the square root of the energy times the square root of c times some number, which follows immediately from here. And okay? So what we've done is use the central charge to compute the rate of growth of states in the theory at high energies. Okay? So you see, this is another interpretation of the central charge. It's an interpretation that makes clear that the central charge tells you how much stuff you have in your theory. More precisely, it tells you how fast the density of states in your theory grows with age. Okay? Theories with larger central charges have more degrees of freedom. As you see most clearly from here, the free energy function of temperature is proportional to the central charge. So if you have n non-interacting fields, the free energy is n times that field. So c is like number of degrees of freedom.
Also,
questions
like that when c is less than 1, we have less
degrees. That's right. So small c is a few states. Okay? So we come this again a rather general conclusion that has used a very little input. The input it has used is unitarity. It's used unitarity in concluding we know the energy of the lowest energy state. Okay? It's used moduli invariance, which is a fact that the torus partition function is well defined. Now, provided that you have done your deformative theories defined by path integral on some
on torus, you know, it's just a very, using basically very few requirements, we've got a very powerful conclusion of immediately. Okay, so now we've got many different ways of thinking of the central charge. The central charge is that object that governs the density of states of the theory at high energies. It's that object that tells you how the theory, the partition function of the theory changes under a Y transformation. It's that object that tells you what the trace of the stress tensor is in a theory in an amplitude. Okay, it's that object that tells you how the stress tensor changes under a Y transformation. Okay, so there are many different roles that the central charge plays. They're all linked to each other in this beautiful web. Okay? So you see that the central charge is an extremely important number that characterizes component. Okay. Okay, good. Unless there are questions or comments, that's it for my general discussion of the probability of theories. I want to now start the discussion of the free scalar theory in detail to flesh out some of these ideas, also because we're going to need this theory. A lot. Questions or comments? Okay, so now let's move on to a study of a particular conformality theory. We start with a very trivial one, yet one that is extremely useful in the study of string theory, namely the theory of free scalar fields. So this is the theory that appears in the world sheet of the string, as we saw in our first few lectures. And its action, as you remember, was S is equal to 1 over 4 pi alpha prime, integral square root of g del alpha x mu theta x mu g alpha beta. And as in our study of string theory, we will mostly focus on this conformality theory on the background metric G. Flatness. Okay. So the first thing that I wanted to understand. So what's part of the action of our theory? The partition function of our theory is exponential of minus the actions minus 1 by 4 pi, right? Del alpha x mu. And let me, since we've got a bunch of decoupled conformality theories, one for each mu, to start with, I'll study the theory with just one x. It easily had copies of it. Okay. Now, the first thing I want to do is to derive the Green's function for all these free scalar fields of this theory. You know many ways to do this. Okay, anyone who's familiar with study quantum field theory knows many ways to do this. I'm going to use, you know, search the error factors, right? I'm going to give you a first principles derivation, using, as we will always try to do in this course, a path integral. You know, path integrals. So, what is Green's function? A Green's function is the value you get when you add the equation of motion derivative del square from master space scalar field on the two-point function of a field. Okay? Now, you get something non-zero only because, as usual, you have this time order in your problem. Because the field is away the equation of motion. So you might think, why, when I add del square on a two-point function, why don't I just get zero? It's the same as the discussion we had for the current, exactly, the current conservation. You don't get to zero because you add them delta functions of time ordering as well. Okay? So, what we want to do is to try to understand how the equations of motion act on correlation functions. Now, there. Fine. So, let's see. What is the equation of motion? Equation of motion is the derivative of the action with respect to some field. Okay? So, let's first try to understand why the equation of motion is true, at least as an operator expectations. Okay? That is true, it's obvious. It's obvious from the fact that the integral of a total derivative is zero. So consider the following. Consider integral of del by del x at some sigma of e to the power minus 1 by 4 by alpha, right? Del alpha x, del alpha x. This should be 0 as long as the path integral is well defined. This should be 0 because it's the integral of total derivative. We shouldn't have boundary terms which are far away in infinity. Okay? But now let's compute all this. So this 0 is equal to this. Now let's take the derivative. So we get the exponential once again, so integral of e to the power minus 1 by 4 pi alpha prime del x squared times one by two pi alpha prime. There are two minus signs. The minus sign here and the minus sign that I get when doing integration by parts. Del square of x. That's it. Okay. So our first conclusion is that if there are no other operators inserted, at least no other operators inserted at the point sigma, then okay, so we could have any number of operators inserted here, O1, O(n), as long as the insertion points of these operators are not sigma. Okay? Then this manipulation will go through, we get O1, O(n), because in differentiating this, the derivative doesn't act with O1 to O(n), it's local, it's a local function of the field six, sigma, and the insertion point is not sigma. Okay. Very good. So we concluded that the correlation function of the equation of motion with any other operator is zero, provided these operators are not at the same point. So that's the statement that as an operator equation, the equation of motion is true. But we haven't yet got what we get out of this delta function, the time ordering delta function differentiation, from this point of view. So now let's be a little more careful. Let's look at let's look at a particular case. Let's look at the case where we have delta by delta x of sigma. Then we have x of sigma prime e to the power minus s times x of sigma prime and then O1 to O(n) such that all these other operators are not coincident with sigma, but x of sigma prime could be at the point sigma. So now we get two terms. The first term we get is delta of sigma plus sigma minus sigma, right? That's equal to power minus s times O1 to O(n). And the second term we've already evaluated, so let's write it as delta of sigma plus sigma prime minus sigma prime plus 1 by 2 pi alpha prime del square of x of sigma prime. All of this inside the integral. This is equal to 0. Is this clear? Okay, very good. Clear, gentlemen? Okay, great. So, we concluded that as, as an operator statement, del squared of 2 pi alpha prime times x of sigma prime, and any number of other operator insertions as long as they're not coincident with sigma, prime, is equal to minus delta of sigma minus sigma prime, that'll be obvious. You can forget about correlation function 1, this is just an operator statement. Because the reason that we aren't going to allow the other operators to be bang on top is why would other delta functions? This is an operator statement, this is true. Okay. Now what? So, now, if we wanted to, we could use this to compute expectation value of x of sigma, because we know that del squared by 2 pi alpha prime of this is equal to minus delta sigma x, right? We also
although this thing is translationally invariant, and so it depends only on the difference of sigma and sigma prime rotation invariant, blah blah blah. So it must be some function that depends on modulus of sigma by sigma prime. Okay? This is the usual green function problem, and we've already in this class solved the problem. Okay? We know that the solution to this is simply log r alpha prime minus alpha prime. Right, because del squared and log r gives you 2 pi, cancels this, the alpha prime cancels this, and the minus sign gives you the minus. Okay? Now it's more convenient to write this in terms of z and z bar. So instead of r, we write z and z bar, but that's r squared, so we need pi 2. Function of our theory, namely the expectation value of 2-pi functions of operators, is given by minus alpha prime by 2 log of z times sigma. Well, I mean, this is z minus w times z minus w. Is this clear? Okay, very good. So that's our first calculation in this theory. It's a very important calculation. It's one that we will use all the time. Okay. Now the next question we're going to ask is, what is the stress tensor? As we know, the stress tensor plays a very important role Okay, so we've already computed this. Right at the beginning, when we were doing string theory, remember the stress tensor was simply the constraint equations. And you remember that it's del x, that tzz is del x, tzz bar is that bar. It just has to be consistent with the conventions we've done to get the constants, right? Okay? And I'm not going to go through and check, just to tell you that the right value is t is minus 1 by alpha prime, del x, and the similar formula for bar. Okay, you trace through the definition of what the stress tensor was and apply it to this action. Okay. Now, the first question that you might have in your mind is, what does this mean? What does this mean? Because, you know, while in the quantum field theory, an operator which is linear in the field makes a lot of sense. Bilinears don't make so much sense. Because you have short-distance singularities when operators come together. Okay? So before proceeding with that discussion, as is generally true in the study of quantum field theory, whenever you deal with composite operators, namely operators that are made out of products of basic fields, you need to define what you mean. Okay? You need to define what you mean, because if by a composite operator you just meant phi at x plus phi at x plus epsilon, limit epsilon goes to 0, insert it into the path integral, the answer to that question is infinite, almost. Because of the short distance singularity in phi x meeting phi x left. Okay. So insertion of that quantity into a path integral makes no sense. By operator, we mean an insertion into a path integral. And if I literally meant to insert this at the same point, or more precisely insert it, in the limit of the points goes to 0, the difference between the points goes to 0, I would just get nonsense. You're getting infinity. That insertion is not well defined. How do I know that insertion is not well-defined? Well, I know it from here. See, we've already computed that if we take x and x prime, okay, and we look at the vacuum expectation value of that object, it has a singularity when the two points come together. Okay? And then if I took two derivatives here, this log singularity would become a 1 over z squared singularity. Yeah, so that's a pretty bad singularity. Okay? So, by this object, I certainly don't mean just inserting this expression into the path integral. So, what do I? Well, this is always in the study of quantum field theory, the question. What you have to do basically is to define a well-defined insertion into the puppet. Often one uses dimensional regularization and sophisticated techniques to define these operators. However, in the case of AND, because it's a free field theory, there's a very simple thing we can do. And very simple thing is essentially normal. Okay? Now, what I'm going to do is basically normal ordering, but also carefully dealing with the zero ones. See, normal ordering is an unambiguous prescription for oscillators, but it won't know how to deal with zero ones of the problem. You know, there's an ambiguity in how to deal with zero ones. So what I'm going to define for you is how to make sense of operator insertions in a method that is more or less normal ordering for those of you who know Weak's theorem and all of that. But if you never heard of normal ordering, it doesn't matter. I'm just going to define it for you, and we use that definition consistently. Okay, so I'm going to define it simply. I'm going to define, suppose we have x of sigma times x of sigma prime. I'm going to define this symbol which is called conformal normal ordering. Essentially, a slightly souped up version of normal ordering that deals also with zero ones. Okay? And that is equal to x of sigma prime, minus, back to me, minus this one. Okay? What do I mean by this? By this I mean, whenever I put this insertion into the path integral, the thing I actually put in the path integral is this object. Okay. Now the first thing to notice is that the equation of motion is a true equation inside conformal normal. Why is that? Well, if I have del square of x on this, I get something non-zero here. And something non-zero here. But the two non-zero things cancel, more or less by construction. Okay? So, unlike the actual operator product, you know, if you try to use the equation of motion naively on path integrals of operator insertion, you get it. That's wrong, because you're not taking into account the delta functions. But when I do it with normal order operator insertions, what I'm doing is correct. Is this clear? So, something very nice that follows from this immediately is that this quantity, because the equation of motion applies to it, that tells you that del squared of x of sigma times x of sigma prime is equal to zero, which tells you that this normal order product is a genuine genuinely in sum of an analytic and anti-analytic function in the argument of x. You see, the factor was not zero, not quite zero, that allowed singularities. Yeah? Okay? This would be clearer if I, let me do it on del x, del of x prime. If I now act with del bar on this, I simply get zero. I honestly get zero. Okay? I honestly get zero. And therefore, del x, the correlation functions of del x, inside normal order expressions, are genuinely analytic expressions in the point of insertion of del x. Okay? So that, okay, so that tells us that if we have an expression which is normal ordered, and we try to expand, you know, some correlation function that's normal ordered, and we try to expand the correlation function in one of the arguments of the operators, we'll only get analytic terms and no singularities. Is this clear? Okay. Yes, it's a very important point. Okay, so I've only Okay, you see, we said that the equation of motion is a genuine equation inside normal motion. Okay? Act on del x. So del bar of del x is just zero. inside the domain, okay? Which means that the correlation function as a function of the insertion point of delta x is an analytic function of that insertion point. It's a genuine analytic function.
But that is true only when it is non-ordering.
When it's not ordering. So inside normal ordering, the correlation functions of inside normal ordering are genuinely analytic functions of delta x inside normal ordering.
But in general, when we write the correlation functions, we will not have normal ordering for that.
That's correct. But the statement I'm making is for normal. Okay? And therefore, such correlation functions are analytic functions of the insertion points of the operators. When they exist, right? And cannot have singularities. Okay, let's continue. You see, we define normal ordering as a product of a product of two operators. Okay, by the way, now any number of derivatives of x is just defined the same way. And you perform the same derivative operation on the subtraction. In a way, you don't really need to define normal ordering or derivative of x, because derivatives are just differences between these two insertions. So once you know how to deal with insertions of x, you know how to deal with insertions of derivatives. Again, fine. Now, what if we have a product of three x's? X of sigma 1, x of sigma 2, x of sigma 3. Okay? The normal order... I'm going to define normal ordering by the following recursive expansion. I'm going to define normal ordering by saying that this is equal to x normal order x of sigma 1, x of sigma 2, x of sigma 3, plus x of sigma 1, normal order x of sigma 2, plus x of sigma 1 times contraction. Well, this is Wick's theorem, but it would be Wick's theorem if we had an independent definition. At the moment, it's my definition. Yeah, but it's a definition that agrees with Wick's theorem. Yes. Okay, plus x of sigma 2 times.
You're not defining normal ordering for any operator like above.
I just defined it for product of two operators.
Yeah, I mean, you haven't defined it in terms of the oscillators. I mean, this is just a definition. Had you defined it in terms of the oscillators and then
right.
Like this, it would have been the...
It would have been the same. Exactly. You see, this was a definition for what it means to insert normal order of product of two x's.
Why should we be careful about this? I think the data we have defined, three operators is that minus that.
Three operators of what? This is the definition. Sorry, what you were suggesting? Alternative definition?
Then why can't we just define the normal ordering of three operators?
Huh?
Also, as that minus.
That minus. No, then you won't get rid of. That minus back from expectation, that will bother you. You want to get rid of all singularities.
Okay.
So you want to get rid of singularities even when two operators come near to each other and one is far away. That won't do it for you. Okay, you want an expression which is totally non-singular. And therefore makes sense to insert into it. Okay, so what we've done here does that for you. You see, when we define it, you take it. Right? And then what it does is separate out the singularity from two operators coming nearby times this operator, which is wherever it is. Blah, 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 blah. Okay. So this is our definition of normal. This recursive procedure defines what we mean by normal order expression of three operators. Same thing is going to go through for n operators. Okay? So by normal order, if you've got a product of n operators, you expand that in sum over all contractions times whatever's left behind. Now sum over all contraction pairs times whatever's left behind normal order, and so on.
Is this clear? I'm not saying it very clearly. You understand what I mean? So, let me say it again. Suppose you have the product of n of n, just the ordinary product. Okay? By my definition, this product is equal to normal order product of n operators plus normal order product of n minus 2 operators times contraction of the remaining 2 operators with a sum taken over all possible permutations plus normal order of n minus 4 operators times contractions of 2 operators in pairs with sum taken over all possible permutations and so on. Okay? That is my recursive definition that defines what normal order of n operators means. Because having defined this at n minus 2, I already knew what it was by n minus 2. So this equation has only one undetermined element. Maybe the guy that's normal order. Okay, is this clear? I'm still going to write a formula for what this normal order operator is. But this is generally the most convenient way to calculate rather than use a formula. So you should understand what the definition is, you know, intuitively rather than perform. Okay, so this is my definition of normal operator. I'm going to leave the following exercise for you. Exercise. Check that with this definition of normal ordering, okay, the equation of motion holds inside normal ordering for an arbitrary product of operators, not just product, two operators. The equation of motion holds as a genuine equation. And therefore, for instance, inside normal ordering, the correlation functions of del x are genuinely analytic. Okay? Are genuinely analytic inside an arbitrary normal order product. Okay. Now, these words may sound a little confusing. It's always nice to have an equation to replace words in a definition. The words that I just said can be written down in the following equation. Suppose I've got some operator O, some product of operators, this is not necessarily local, it's product of operators at x1, x2, x3. Okay. I want to expand that in a normal order series. Okay, so what do I do? What I have to do is to take this two-point function and subtract it for every contraction. Okay? Now, so the two-point function was minus alpha by 2 log of mod z squared. So, subtraction of the two-point function is plus alpha prime by 2 log of z1 minus z2 the whole thing squared, d2z1, d2z2, okay? And let's put delta by delta